Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, good whatever you are when you're listening to this podcast. My name is Alan and this is the Digitally Uploaded Podcast, freshly squeezed for you. So this week we've got a bit of an issue because Matt's currently off in Japan actually having a fun time. So I've been allowed to make a free roam podcast. Well, not necessarily allowed, he just hasn't said no to it because he's in Japan. So I've essentially created an elite team of some sort of suicide squad, I guess. Of people who are here to help ruin the high quality of digitally downloaded .net. With me this week, we have Trent.
Hello. If this would be also the third week we've had a bad podcast, if this goes well. So
this is the best kind of bad podcast. This is now a cursed podcast. we also have Harvard. Hello, Harvard.
Good morning. If you've been around for a while, you'll know that I've been ruining DDNet for 5 years now.
Hooray!
Oh my god,
actually 5 years? Dude.
Almost, yeah.
It's been wow. That's a long time. That's impressive.
It's a lot of ruining.
Yeah, it's a lot of ruining. And of course, you probably heard her by now. But yep. It's Ginny. Hooray.
Yay! It's me. Again.
It's me.
Me.
Yeah. Yeah, okay.
God, that was so bad. Hello.
So, yeah, Ginny's here. Hooray. So we're going to go to some music. I don't know if it's going to be Miki music. I might mix it up. It might be something completely different.
We didn't even pick music.
No, I'm going to pick music. It's just not going to be Miku based,
I
think.
What about rap music? Because I know Matt hates that.
Miki said, what about rap music? Yeah. Just rats just chirping.
Pokemon rap.
Rap music. Think about... I don't know. Just...
I'll find something neato. You'll all love it. You're gonna love it.
Put in that GTA rap. That's like video games and rap, right? That's all I can think of.
No, we're cutting.
Video games at all, okay? Just rap. It's like a really offensive rap song about ladies with big asses.
Alright, we're gonna cut that now. Moving on. We'll see you back in a second.
Thank you.
And let's get back to the topic at hand. So we've got a new game coming out this week called State of Decay 2, and I'm sure that the entire world is just screaming in anticipation for another zombie game, because we need one. Because there are so little zombie games currently in the world out there right now that I'm just, you know, I'm stoked to be able to experience this sort of thing again. So to give a little bit of a lowdown, State of Decay 2 comes out on the... Oh, it came out on the 18th, so you would have already had it in your hands by now, which is exciting. If you think that's exciting, good for you. And it has been met with possibly the most apathetic of responses, which is not surprising, to be totally honest, because it's a zombie game in 2018. Who could have seen that one coming? So I don't know. I feel like this entire genre of games is just out of style, and it's the old version of Battle Royale in a sense that it is now like so oversaturated and so bleh that I have zero interest in any game that has it at this point. You know, like, I don't know, Ginny, like, what do you think? Do you like the Zombles?
I do not like zombified byproducts of the Wiggles and Wombats. Fucking, but
oh my god. Okay, that's an in joke. We're banning in jokes for the moment. Okay, unless you want right. to explain
I
what
was,
that is.
I was going to explain it. So, for context, as we were setting up for this really, really great podcast, we were just doing some light reading on Pockin, and I had mispronounced Pockin and said Fockin instead, and I had to look it up because obviously, Fockin, Pockin, like the possibilities for video content endless. So, I looked up.
Like, I love that you're describing this in such a generally calm manner.
Yeah, so I looked up Pockin, as you do, because I'm a curious person, and I felt like I should share this information with my co-host. And lo and behold, Pockin is actually a Dutch word, and it comes from the English word fuck and the Dutch word Pockin. And actually, Pockin means to breed. So there you go. So when I used Pockin in the context before, when Alan said, you know, sort of, said that refer to zombies as zombles. We had an in joke earlier about the womble. This is going on.
This is literally the most elongated explanation for something that honestly is okay, about like a listen. 6 out of 10 joke.
Okay, fine. The wombles are when wombats and the wiggles fucking, okay? When he said zombles earlier, that's what he implied. Zombie versions of wombles, which is basically what happens when humans breed with wombats, okay? That's not even a thing. Anyway, unimportant.
We've said that the download podcast isn't educational.
I actually forgot what the point of my joke was, like halfway through, because I got distracted by the fucking, but that doesn't matter. So in terms of zombie games, I actually really liked Left 4 Dead, but that was like the only zombie franchise I liked. I literally couldn't give any shits about State of Decay. And I sort of like only liked The Walking Dead because it wasn't really about zombies. It was about human nature and suffering.
Oh, so, I love the Walking Dead game that was made by Overkill that was the worst thing ever because you could play as Meryl and Daryl.
Oh, no. The Walking Dead mobile game, I highly recommend it if you're, like, really, really stoned.
Anyway. This podcast does not support drugs.
Sorry, no, we don't support drug use. But if you are hypothetically stoned, you should play a shitty mobile game like the Walking Dead one because it will just make it so much more fun. But anyway...
I'd like to really quickly apologize to Matt. If you're listening to this, I'm so sorry.
It's all Alan's fault.
This is what happens when you give me power.
But honestly, I agree with Alan, though. Like, not in terms of, yes, he is ruining this podcast because you gave him power, Matt. But zombie games, as a whole, I sort of feel like we should have left them behind in the Left 4 Dead 2 era. Like, I think they really, really outwore their welcome. Like, what was it? Call of Duty, World War 2, zombie mod, whatever. Like, it's just all that kind of zombie shit. It's just like a shtick. It is exactly like what we're seeing now with Battle Royale and what we saw earlier with what, like, 16-bit, 8-bit platformers, like a return to vintage. Like, it's over. We're done. And State of Decay 2 being a game that has incredible game-breaking bugs and
like
just horrific physics.
Like, sky-spawning zombies.
And terrible production and zombies flying from the sky. It's like they're not even trying to do anything quality with these spin-off content now that they've got the zombie stuff. It's just like they've tacked it off for no particular reason. The game could just die in a shithole for all I care. I am so over zombies.
Oh my god. Okay, so I know for a fact that Trent's a bit more positive on the game because he enjoyed the original. So maybe we should have like some sort of counterbalance. Whereas Ginny's is saying this game should burn. Yeah, I want Trent like to explain game? Why it's actually good.
So I haven't played the second one, so probably a bad counterbalance point, but I did enjoy the original. This original game was clearly a 5 out of 10 as well, but it had the bare bones to build a structurally pleasing game. And if they actually put some money into it, put some time into it, the sequel would have been enjoyable. It would have been great. And from Guinea's great explanation about...
You call me Guinea. Let's just rewind. I need to rewind this. Hold on. Let me just rewind a little bit. I feel like I'm doing like a rewind animation with my hand right now. I'm rewinding the conversation. What? You call me?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Moving on. Should I continue?
Yes. Like, it had the essence of being a great, excellent title, but it's not. It's, you know, so while I enjoyed, you know, the original, it was great that it had some home building, it had some, you know, structurally, you know, supporting your, you know, I just saw the text message come up and I'm just like, it's ruined my whole spiel. It had great structure in the whole thing to basically allow it to be a playable experience where you basically had, I'm going to have this person from a village. I'm going to save him. He's going to be my plantologist, and we're going to go out there and we're going to kill some zombies. Like, it had that raw, like, because in a zombie game, you don't want everyone to be dead. Like, you know, you just don't want to be shooting everything. You want some, at least some, you know, structure and some, you know, logic and some, let's build a community back up again sort of thing. That's why I like things like The Division. I felt that really should have had more community building. Let's, you know, the world is fucked. Let's restore it to some logical place. And I really wish the sequel went that way, but apparently not.
Yeah, so I don't think there's a more boring concept right now than the idea of a I Am Legend sort of game. Because a lot of those sorts of zombie games, I feel like, are moving into this whole thing of, like, I am the individual. I am the lone survivor. It's boring as all sorts of things. I just don't have any interest in that. And the majority of interesting things that I would see is coming from this, you know, like, build some form of defense, make a community, make something interesting. And like you were saying, Trent, like, I think State of Decay definitely had a chance to have that done really well. And, you know, Microsoft have been pushing it as a big thing. Like, they have been, I've been seeing YouTube ads on this game, which is insane because I don't have any intention of ever buying it. But yeah, it seems like, once again, Microsoft is sort of throwing itself down into a pit of exclusives that don't really make me want to buy an Xbox. So I don't know. I have very, very little interest right now in that. And I think we can all agree on this, but Days Gone, the upcoming game from Santa Monica.
No, put me out of my misery.
Like, such, it just, I have zero interest. And this is coming from a man who also didn't have any interest in God of War and went on to praise God of War like it's my actual son. But
your actual son.
Yeah, he's my actual son. The game is my actual son. I put it in a little tuxedo. I walk it around on a skateboard. It's great.
Do you have the time to read stuff for you? Boy, what does that say?
Yeah, every lecture I go into at this point at university is just me shouting at a game copy of God of War to read out the lecture slides so I can write them down. Yeah, wow. So
we have derailed.
We have derailed. So I just have zero interest in Days Gone, and I think State of Decay 2 is sort of the beginning of me being aggressively apathetic towards it. Like, it seems fine. It seems fine.
I don't know if a 5 out of 10 average is fine.
In my mind, a 5 out of 10 is average. That is an average game, and I don't know. I have zero interest in playing an average game at this point.
Yeah, there's so many good games out there that, you know, are probably around the same price point. Like, don't subject yourself to this game if you're not a huge fan of zombies and or incredibly average and boring characters and stereotypes. Don't buy this game. There are other games that are $30. Don't buy this shit. Cool.
Yeah. Harvard, what do you think? Would you buy this game? If I gave you a game that had a zombie in it, would you be upset?
I mean, I didn't know that State of Decay 2 was really coming out.
That's a really good sign. Honestly, that's a great...
There's nothing that
stands out to me. Just putting a point on that. If he didn't know that State of Decay 2 isn't coming out, that's like a big push from Microsoft. There's a big thing in their whole Xbox, games for Xbox. Like, one of the big titles for this year for the Xbox is State of Decay 2, and Harvard knows nothing about it.
Yeah, you're right.
Targeted ads gotten really smart now. Like, targeted ads, they know that I have zero interest in Xbox or zombie games, so they just don't even bother me anymore.
They've given up on you. You're a lost cause.
Yeah.
I'm just like a little black hole in the Marconi apartment. The last one I played was... if you don't count, like, Resident Evil... Oh, hey, Alan, I'm playing Resident Evil 4, by the way.
Oh, yeah! Resident Evil 4 is, like, the best thing ever. Cool. All right.
Take it forever. But last proper zombie game I played was probably Left 4 Dead as well. Yeah. And that was back in the craze of, like... Well, I was young at the time, and, like, my high school friends had just discovered violence, so it was cool. But now it's like we go back and see that, and it's like, oh, that's just really juvenile. Like, you don't really see the point of it anymore.
Yeah, well, I don't know, but Valentine 2 is basically what I want from a new Left 4 Dead game, because it's got the light RPG elements, and I like me some light RPG elements. so, yeah, if a zombie game is actually going to try and hold any interest for me, it needs to go either the Walking Dead Telltale Season 1 route of actually having characters that make me care about things, mm-hmm. or it has to go for some sort of other thing that's not just, it's a zombie game, but you got an axe. It's not interesting. It's never interesting. It's not at all what I'm there for, so.
What about if it's like a zombie game, but you have like a blade, and you have to master the way of the blade?
While you're studying, studying the blade.
It's cool, actually. If you're like a traveling swordsman, like in those like Japanese films, and then it's just zombies for some reason.
Yeah, well.
It does sound a bit like Onimusha.
State of Decay 2 has a character that has to master the blade, so.
Do they have a trench coat as well?
I don't believe so. So you have a blade guy and a hacker guy. So.
Oh, he's cool. Does he have fingerless gloves?
I suspect in this sort of apocalyptic aesthetic where they're wearing kind of shitty puffer jackets and tattered clothing that people probably have fingerless gloves. So,
that's pretty sick.
Yeah, I agree. So if you like blades and the way of the blade, maybe you'll like State of Decay 2. I don't know.
That is an indictment if I've ever heard one. We're going to move to some music now. so we're going to be listening to a little bit of Nier Automata because I like that game a lot and it's very pretty.
you will not believe how much you can save. So swing on by and then purchase things till you're broke. Prices so low that you need a great sword to slash them more. Any lower would be
And welcome back from that wonderful piece of music from Nier Automata. Please play the game if you have not already. It's very, very good. So we've had a bit of a thing this year, unfortunately, so far, that Janice has pointed out, where a bunch of games have been removed from Steam for essentially... How would you describe it, Ginny?
Because Steam is a corporation and it's terrible and evil. So basically, there have been some inconsistent ruling on quote-unquote sexy Steam games, and a bunch of them have been removed, and some are now being threatened with removal. So these are all, just to clarify, these are all actually visual novel games. So there are a whole bunch of explicit games on Steam, which include games like Outlast and Outlast 2 and whichever other Australian game involves you hacking your dick off. They're still on Steam. That's
why is it being Australian good about hacking your dick off?
Listen, it's just about, I came across it once. I erased it from my memory because sausages are not my thing. But regardless, that happened. And there are still some very, very explicit games out there with very adult content on Steam that have not been threatened with removal. But recently, there's sort of been more and more write-ups about this because I guess they're affecting more and more visual novel developers. But the long story short is that Manga Gamer, who is a really, really prolific VM publisher, they've received lots of notices that, yeah, games might be removed for pornographic content. So just for some sort of backstory on the kinds of games that are being removed, obviously we know that it's like a sort of like a soft spot in terms of like, you know, cultural sensitivity and stuff like that, and how often people will, I guess, misinterpret or have some ideas about what Japanese VN games are like. But Manga Gamer, because they do so many VN games, they've had a system with Valve and their reps where they sort of like talk to them one-on-one and confirm that the content in their games is like sort of tailored and approved by the Steam marketplace, if that makes sense. So
yeah,
they've always sort of gone through Valve and been like, hey, look, this is our game. What's, you know, what's okay or what's not okay with it? And so basically Valve has always come to an agreement with them about the kind of games that they can actually sell on the marketplace. And they've sort of allowed these games and agreed in writing in with these games, like, hey, okay, this is not, I guess, what we would traditionally see as okay, but you can publish it. And when I say this is not what we see as okay, I sort of mean that games that have some light sexual content, like soft petting or like women in bras, or two ladies in bras together in a relationship kind of thing. So that was sort of the understanding that was okay on Steam, because I mean, people are out here chopping their dicks off on Steam, so why not? But now, however...
So why not?
Now,
sounds like a Seinfeld skit.
Yeah, but now Steam is like, actually, this stuff is way too adult, so we're going to change our rules. I don't know why I put like a weird white
name. What's the deal with that?
We're going to change our rules, and actually... What the stuff that we said was okay to sell is now pornographic. Oh, so you know, I guess you can't sell your games anymore. Which is really weird.
You went from that accent of like Jerry Seinfeld circa 1995 into a like 1800s aristocrat.
Listen, so Okay, so, and I mean, like, yeah, for one, I can understand why a game like Hoonie Pop, which in case you've never heard about it, it's a game where you match three, and then when you match three really well, a lady orgasms and shows you her bits. I can see why that was removed for being pornographic. But visual novels that have sort of like light kissing scenes or like sort of scenes with same-sex couples kind of gently touching on each other with clothes on, that's far less explicit than like The Witcher. And like, you know, like Geralt fucking going to town and some succubus's asshole. Like, you know, that stuff is...
So you already had one example that was perfectly fine with The Witcher, but you decided to just go with going to town on that ass.
Listen, Geralt is a freak, okay? We all know this. But I'm just saying, the sex scenes of The Witcher are much more explicit than what you get in most run-of-the-mill sort of softcore romance VNs. So to me, it's mind-boggling as to why these VNs are being threatened with removal, but we can still buy games where you chop your dick off and buy Witcher 3 on Steam. Like, what is the rationale here? It seems to be all Japanese VNs as well. So I don't know if this is like a discrimination thing or like a weird foreign policy thing, because Valve is completely jacked and can't even do tax law right. But what is happening? Can someone just educate me,
please? Do you
think
it's the framing of it, perhaps? Because Witcher 3 is not really framed as a romance game. Even though there's like obviously heavy like plot lines of that throughout the entire thing, because Yennefer is awesome. Do you think it's the framing of the games as this is a romance visual novel with elements of softcore pornography? Like, is that, do you think that that might be the reason that Valve is saying that this is not okay on our platform? We don't want to be seen as, you know, selling, you know, what is essentially softcore pornography, even though it's not bad? Because I can kind of see it. I can kind of see why they would not want to stock something like that. Because I don't ever go into, like, for example, an EB Games. I don't go in there and, you know, see Honey Pop on the store shelf at all. Like, that is just not a thing that I've ever seen before. Because I just guess they don't want to be associated with that sort of content, maybe?
No, they can't sell it to underage 10-year-olds. So they, you know, they won't stock it on the shelf.
Yeah. I mean, like, I understand that. So, like, as once again, like I said, like, I understand why Hoodie Pots were removed for being pornographic, because that makes sense to me, because that game is pretty lewd. I understand that, and I'm okay with that if that's their starts. Like, you know, I understand that Valve is like, we can't sell a game whereby you have to, like, get a woman drunk via a match three game, make her orgasm, and then take her clothes off. That is, I understand that not being okay, and I respect that decision. But I think it's sort of like the other sort of tamer VNs that are not actually about any sexual content. Like, there are some VNs out there made by queer studios that are actually not explicit at all. And those are sort of being tarred with the same brush as Hoonie Pop. So for me, I get that if you want a bad Hoonie Pop, I'm not complaining. That's completely fine. I've gotten my 78 hours out of it, which is way too much.
That's not what I was expecting, to be totally honest with you.
Look, I've got it, my money's worth out of Hoonie Pop. You know, ban it all you want. It's fine. It is a very explicit game. But I think that if you're going to enforce that standard, you need to sort of keep to that standard. You can't sort of just go, okay, that's one Japanese VN or I guess sort of light relationship type game that's going to be banned. Therefore, every other Japanese VN game about relationships has to be banned as well. I think if you want to draw the line and be pornographic, do that, but don't ban the games that don't have ladies' bits in them or bras or, like, you know, weird mechanics like that. Like, just leave the other VNs alone.
Yeah, for sure. You're also talking to someone who I could not be less interested in visual novels most of the time.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I just don't understand this sort of double standard effect, because something like Outlast 2, where you literally see your entire lower bits get taken away with a pickaxe, that's one of the worst things I've ever seen in my life, and I don't want to see that, because that's just gross. And I don't understand why, you know, something like what you're describing is being treated as worse for seemingly no reason. It confuses me a lot, and I don't really know what Valve is doing. I also don't really know what they're doing most of the time.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a mystery, but yeah, I guess these people are receiving more notices now about their games potentially being pulled. So it's kind of getting more traction now, but it's been going on for a while, and they've had these arrangements since 2016, I believe, for most studios. So, as to why Valve is kind of backing out on what they agreed on previously, I don't know. But I guess there are other platforms to buy VNs on if you really want them. But that's not the point, right? The point is
if you're not on Steam as a developer, it's very, very hard to gain traction because you can be on GOG, you can be on Green Man Gaming, but it's not going to be the same as having your game on the storefront in Steam, which, let's be real here, is a monopoly, unfortunately. Like, the way that it has been set up in the world at the moment, surely you'll have people who like me, who will go to Green Man Gaming, who will go to GOG, and they'll buy games on there because they want that experience. But the regular person who's on a computer and is just wanting to play whatever, they're going to go to Steam. And to remove a bunch of games like that, even though, like, I personally have zero interest in it, it just seems very, very, very callous. Let's go with callous. It's a good word. And it, I don't know, I can't see this actually being a good thing at all. It'll be interesting to see how it develops in the coming months or so, because this will potentially change a lot of what Valve is going to be doing, which is very interesting because we still have absolute trash fire games on that platform.
Oh, yeah, there's so many.
There is too many bad games. It's actually heartbreaking. So I guess with that, we might cut to a little bit of music. I've got Final Fantasy IV's Red Wings theme. This is probably one of my favorite Final Fantasy games just because of the opening, I want to say 20 minutes, and this song is wonderful in it. So,
enjoy. We're not going to play the whole 20 minutes, right?
No, we're not going to play the entire 20 minutes.
Yeah, trend. What did you think was going to happen?
Well, it's okay because Elliot is running the podcast this week.
Yeah, Elliot is running the podcast. Welcome back. So we mentioned it briefly that Judy had put 70 hours into Hunipop, however you pronounce it. And there's a new feature on one of the sites that we also mentioned called, I believe, Green Man Gaming, where you can check what your dollar value per hour is going to be on the game. And this isn't dangerous at all. No, not at all. So for those of you who are not aware, Green Man Gaming launched a new stats and facts thing where they will calculate the average cost per hour of a game. And this is not safe for anything. Like, this is horrendous. So the idea behind it is it calculates what your average playtime will be and then how much the game will cost for you to play per hour. So it's sort of bringing it back to the old arcade style of, this is a, you know, a dollar to play, you'll get this much time of game time out of that. But it's on a grander scale, obviously, because you're buying in a full scale game. I really dislike this. I think this is a terrible, terrible idea, because it not only devalues games, and I hate the dollar an hour idea, because that's simply unreasonable, because if you went into a film, you'd be paying $1.50 then, and that's stupid. I just can't see this ever being a good thing, because a game like Portal, where it only lasts, let's be honest, about 3 or 4 hours, I had a much better time with that game than a lot of games I've spent, you know, 20 hours in, simply because it was just a better, more cohesive experience. So to sort of reduce a game to the average cost per hour seems so counterproductive, so, so counterproductive. And the worst thing is that I get why it exists. Like, I understand why this feature is now here, because as a uni student, I do look at the cost of a game and I think, okay, well, how much game time can I get out of it? And unfortunately, that means I'm pretty much reduced to playing a lot of open world games at this point, which is so great. It's so good. I love it. It's just grouse. But it just seems so, so dangerous. This seems like the worst idea. It's screaming a little bit, but that's all right. I guess, like, Harvard, what would you say about this, other than this is a absolute trash fire of an idea?
I mean, how do you measure dollars per hour? Do you measure like 100% completion, or do you measure like story completion?
And I think what's the point? Exactly. Like, how do you do this? Like, what is the method of doing this? It seems so stupid.
And there's so many games that are like, when you finish the main story, that's like 30%, and the extra 70% is just wasting your damn time for the next 200 hours. Like, I think a good example is something like Just Cause, where the open world is something like 40 square world kilometers or whatever. It's like the size of your average city. And every square kilometer is like so many things to do in it. They don't expect everyone to finish it. But if you wanted to max out your dollars per hour, you'd just buy that game and play it for the next 3 years, and it would have things for you to do. But
yeah,
you would hate games by the end of that. You would be like, oh, I hate games. I would never touch a video game ever again. Just Cause like ruined my life.
Oh, Jesus.
It's such
you sound like heroin. Like, okay. Yeah, no, but I completely agree with you, though. Like, there is no conceivable way you can measure a game's average cost per hour without reducing it to content. And I know that Matt's going to be screaming at the use of the word content, so I'm going to use it once more, content.
Games as a service, then.
Oh, get out of here.
Games as a service.
That's so true, though. And you're all saying, oh, let's play open world games because that maximizes my dollar per hour value. But I don't know about you guys, but a lot of the open world games, I don't finish. There's just too much content. Like, it gets...
Oh, yep. Tell me more.
Like, it gets to the point where I'm like, you know, because there's so much content which is more in side stories or, you know, back-end stuff, knives and stuff like that, like, the actual main structure of the game or the story is, like, second nature, like, you know, like, second to, like, all that stuff. And when you're playing it, a lot of open world games just start seeing, you know, like, they involve the player and captivate them that well these days. It's more about, oh, you can do this.
You can do it, but why would you want to, though?
Yeah, you can collect all these frogs or something. I don't know.
Why'd you be collecting frogs? Is that a side quest in a game? Because I would love to collect these frogs.
I don't know. I just picked a random animal. All right. So you're collecting these frogs, and there's like a billion of them, and by the end of it, you get like golden armor or something.
Yeah, it's like, you're making a very big allusion, I feel, to the Zelda quest where you collect the Korok seeds.
Yes,
you get a golden bird, and like, who actually cares? Like, who actually cares outside of crazy people who want to collect everything in that game? Like, it seems so stupid. And again, going on with the games as a service thing, which is I want to talk about in Call of Duty, even though no one else gives a single shit. That game is now moving towards egg games as a service. And you can hear Activision like slowly clicking their mandibles together.
On the sound of money falling from the ceiling. Around their office.
So Overwatch does it really well currently, even though that is also an Activision game. In that the updates are fairly regular. They add enough content that, add enough content that, you know, it keeps me interested. Like, they'll add skins, they'll add, you know, recently I had the breast cancer research skin for Mercy, which I think is awesome, personally.
Magical girl Mercy. Support breast cancer awareness as well.
Yes, absolutely. That's like the best of both worlds. Hannah Montana. Let's go. Hannah Montana is a games as a service. Best of both worlds. The seminal song.
Yeah. Come on, guys.
Yeah, I haven't heard of Hannah Montana for... What year is it?
2018.
So she was the year in 2007, I want to say. That was the peak of her show. Anyway, so, you know, Overwatch, like I was saying, does it really well. And that's fine because they keep adding maps, they keep adding content again. Uh-huh. That makes me want to keep coming back to the game. But whenever I see, it's Call of Duty, but it's an online experience. And you can get an average cost per hour of only a dollar, but then we'll also bleed you to death with microtransactions. Which is the most...
See, I'm okay with this whole game as a service thing if it is applied to things like Call of Duty, and that means that every damn year release of Call of Duty is now in this package of the big release. And you can have DLC, you can have whatever on top of that, but that's the game. You buy this Call of Duty, and that's the Call of Duty of the generation. Like, I'm okay with that if that's what it leads to. And it most likely won't, but... Like, if it leads to, like, a superior game of the generation, which just has all the packaging stuff for Call of Duty, I'm okay with buying, like, $100 for Call of Duty and then buying, like, $50 worth of, like, DLC or whatever for parts I actually want to play. Like,
what's your average cost per hour then?
Yeah.
It's going to be $50 per month for the right to play the game. And if you don't pay it, they're going to take away your stuff.
See, I'm crazy. I like the single player.
That does sound real. No, there's no single player anymore.
Oh, no.
No one plays it.
No, I actually... That's the one thing that I'm actually on board with for the new Call of Duty is that they've just said no one plays the single player. No one cares. No one wants to see Kit Harington. Just stop. No, because Kit Harington was in Infinite Warfare or something. He was just evil for no reason. It was terrible. I appreciate what they've done there. I don't like games as a service because I think at a certain point we get to this disastrous area where every game is a game as a service and games are going to start dropping like flies. Like, immediately, because people can't keep up with that many games. Like, I play two games at a point max, and one of them is always Overwatch. So
yeah.
I straight up just do not have the time to do that. And then my average cost per hour to... buy that game and then not play it because I can play something else already. It's just, it doesn't make any sense. And it's going to immediately burst at some point and everyone's going to be like, oh, why is our game as a service not, you know, exploding off into the stars again? It's because there's too many.
What if you could buy in at a level? Like, if you're a noob or someone who plays, like...
No, I don't want that. That's atrocious.
Like, plays for, like, 5 months and then drops off for, like, 2 years, and then your game and all that's gone, and everyone else is, like, on level 99, and you're only on 20. But then you could buy in and be leveled up and have all the golden armor and all that other cool stuff.
No, that's exactly the shitty sort of price point service that you get when you leave World of Warcraft or you leave an MMO, and then they're, like, every other month, they're, like... Here's a free weekend. Have you thought about coming back? Only $90, and you can get like a character boost to max level with raid ready armor. And it's
so
like,
you didn't have the game be played for you.
Yeah, and it's ridiculous because like the part of the fun of an MMO undoubtedly is not only just the end game stuff, but actually going through the story. I don't know about most people, but most people play MMOs to connect with other people and also experience the story of the world that they're actually in. Yes, the endgame stuff is there, but newsflash, you can't do well in endgame raiding if you don't know how to play the game. And giving people the option to not play the game just creates a toxic environment, because you'll get, like, I don't know, you'll get the game, you'll be a complete noob to it, and the game will be like, here, pay $150 to skip all the leveling. You do that, you get to end game, and no one puts you in their raid team because you're just bad at the game. You learn nothing, you hate the game, you become toxic, and then you join, like, a community of toxic people in the game that makes life shit for everyone. So I don't see a win-win for this, and multiplayer games are already so toxic as they are. Like, Overwatch...
Don't even talk to me about Overwatch.
Exactly. Voice chat, don't even go there. Like, do you really want to contribute to making these environments more unpleasant than they already are for people? I don't think so.
It's just, yeah. I first of all would like you to take a breath, Ginny, because you just did like a good old rant, and that was very impressive.
I just played World of Warcraft for so long, okay?
What if it's applied to Call of Duty? Like, you don't have to play Call of Duty. And everyone else who plays Call of Duty, just so we got to say, one friend is like, hey, let's play Call of Duty. I know you don't have the game. And then they're like, fine, I have to get the game. And then you like get the game. And then you like download it on your Xbox or PlayStation or Switch if they ever put a Switch version out.
And that'd then be you're stupid like, not to.
Yeah, I think
and then you've got the shooter. And then you're like, well, my friend's like level 88. He can access all these maps and stuff. I can't. Why can't I do that? I want to frame with my friends. Then, you know, you kind of need to be balanced up with, like, the level your friends are.
If it's maps, I agree, because it's an online shooter. But guns and... I don't like the idea of paying to not have to play a game so you can play the game.
Yeah.
It seems very counterintuitive. It seems terrible. It seems like such a...
It's like another way to make you pay money.
And also that entire process makes it sound like the game developers and designing the game with intentional padding. Like, they're making the game worse so that they can price gouge you, and I think that's dumb. Bad. It's real bad.
I agree.
Oh, we agree on a thing. It's very pleasant. It's
yeah. Good... Yeah, There's Elliot.
Some... Thanks.
Nice. Thanks.
And on that note, I reckon we're gonna call it there. It's actually not been as much a disaster as I thought it would be. And on the notes of Ginny having a slight Apocalypse Now flashback to Warcraft, we're going to play Warcraft 3.
Do not.
We're going to. I've decided.
I'm not going to listen back to this. I can't. It hurts so much.
Something need doing. So we're gonna chuck some of that bad boy on, and we'll see you around next week when Matt's back, probably, if he is back. I don't know when he's coming back. He might be dead.